So I just kissed everybody. A couple people didn't like it, but it's his fault, so. I didn't really kiss anybody, in case you're like, I'm not talking to that guy afterwards. Well, welcome this morning. It's Easter, obviously. We're glad you're here. I want to talk about love this morning. And that might seem like an eye-rollingly simple thing to talk about on Easter, but I promise that you'll see something different about it by the end of our time together today. I love you. Three simple words, some of the most commonly combined words in the whole of human language, no matter where you're from, no matter what your background or your culture, human beings combine these three words. Sometimes we mean them, sometimes we just say them because they're the right thing to say in the moment, or they're the proper response to give to someone who has said the words to us first. The problem with words is that they are hard to understand when they're written on a page without knowing the tone or the context of them. How many times have you ever said to someone in your life that you love, I love you? And then other times you can say the same three words, but they sound like this. I love you. Depending on the tone and the context, the words can mean, I love you, you're my everything, this you're wonderful, I can't live without you. Or they can mean, I tolerate you, why do I put up with you? What was I thinking when we started this thing? It's just true. English is a simpler language. When it comes to theology and trying to make sense of the Bible, English speakers encounter a problem, though, because we're reading something that wasn't written in English. Yes, newsflash this morning, Jesus didn't speak English. He wasn't from Wichita. He was an Easterner, not a Westerner. He didn't shop at Urban Outfitters and wear Birkenstocks. That's not who this person was. He was a Jew living in ancient Palestine where he lived his entire life. He never visited New York City and went to the top of the Empire State Building. Jesus most likely, as almost all people did in his culture at the time, spoke Aramaic in his everyday conversations, but he would have also been able to speak Greek conversationally when it was required of him. So when we here today in modernity read the words of Jesus, we're reading something that was spoken in Aramaic, then written down in Greek, and then translated into English. No wonder scripture can be so confusing. Anyway, the English language, when it comes to understanding scripture, serves as a kind of skin. It's good for getting an overview of the stories in the Bible, but it falls short in a lot of the specifics. Raise your hand if you're still with me this morning. I know this is a little nerdy. All right. Perhaps at the very top of the list of the words in Scripture that we miss the true meaning of when it gets translated into English is the word love. If you read the New Testament in Greek, you'll find that there are actually four Greek words that all get translated into English as simply the word love. Those words are phileo, agape, storge, and eros. Phileo is the love that we see in friendships. It's actually the root word of the name of the city, Philadelphia, Phila, phileo, the city of brotherly love. Phileo is friendship. Storge is love that we experience in a familial context with our families. It's the natural inclination and obligation that we feel to care for those that are closest to us. Eros is where we get the word erotic from. I don't know if I need to say more about this, especially in church, but eros is like this. Ha 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 ha! You get my point, right? And finally, agape. Agape is a love of esteem. And it's coupled together with the idea of highly prizing something. It is the highest kind of love, the highest word for love in the Greek language. It's often translated as love without conditions or unconditional love. And understanding these four words is crucial to understanding the meaning of our passage for today, because its full meaning just doesn't quite come across in the English language. The passage, again, says, "When they finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?' 'Yes, Lord,' he said, 'you know that I love you.' And Jesus said, 'Feed my lambs.' Again, Jesus said, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me?' And he answered, 'Yes, Lord, you know that I love you.' Jesus said, 'Take care of my sheep.' And then a third time, Jesus said to him, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me?' And Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, 'Do you love me?' And he said, 'Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you.' And Jesus said, 'Feed my sheep.'" Now, as we saw last week, after Jesus was captured and handed over to be crucified, all of his disciples desert him. They leave. They're terrified of what's going to happen to them. They're all running and hiding. And in this process of running away, Peter is seen by people in the town. And he's asked three times if he knows this man, Jesus. And he denies it all three times. So post-resurrection, when Jesus sees Peter again, he asks him three times if Peter loves him. And Peter is apparently hurt by this because he realizes that Jesus realizes that he denied knowing him those three times. That's the skin. That's what we get by reading this in English. But there's something even deeper going on here if we look at this passage in the Greek. This is how the text actually reads in Greek. "When they finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, 'Simon, son of John, do you agape me more than these? Do you love me more than anything? Do you love me without conditions? Do you put me first in all instances at the expense of yourself?' And Peter replies, 'Yes, Lord, you know that I phileo you. I love you like a brother. I love you like a friend.' And Jesus said, 'Feed my lambs.'" Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you agape me?" And he answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I phileo you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." And then the third time, Jesus said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you phileo me?" And Peter was hurt because Jesus had asked him the third time, "Do you phileo me?" And he said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I phileo you." Now, there are a lot of opinions out there in the world put forth by brilliant people about what's really going on here. Some scholars say that the words agape and phileo were used interchangeably in this culture. Perhaps, but I've never understood that. It just doesn't make any sense. It's like saying that the words donkey and horse are interchangeable. Like, this would never happen where we live and in this culture. But let's say you and I are celebrating Christmas together and you've asked me to buy you a horse. And you go out to the garage where your gift is supposed to be, and I say, "Merry Christmas," and you slide up the garage door and there's a donkey in there. And you're disappointed. You're like, I said I wanted a horse. And I said, "There's no difference. I bought you a donkey. It's the same thing." And you would be upset, right? Even though horses and donkeys are similar in shape and size and many of their abilities, they're vastly different in the specifics. And so I would even concede that maybe the words phileo and agape could be used interchangeably in the macro sense. Like, if the word love appears in one book of the Bible and the different word for love appears in another book of the Bible, maybe so. But this is about a conversation between two people that only spans two or three sentences. Why would Jesus and Peter be using different words? Well, there can only be one reason for that. Peter's telling Jesus that he loves him. But he only loves him like he would a friend or a brother. Not with the highest kind of love that Jesus is asking him for. And this is where we find ourselves in this Easter story, including myself, all of us who don't love God as we think God thinks we should. I mean, let's just be honest today. For many of us, and this includes me, there are hours, days, sometimes even entire seasons of our lives where we just think of God like our buddy, you know? We just think of God like our friend. We give some of our time and our attention to God on days where we've scheduled it, or when it happens to be convenient, or when we happen to have a free morning or a free evening and we just spontaneously bump into our friend. But here's the problem. God is asking us for agape. And if we're honest with ourselves, as Peter is being in this story, all that we've got is phileo. And after many long years of doing what I do in my career and sitting with literally hundreds of people over the years, I see this trend in people, and I even see it in myself, that we are often filled with these feelings of self-loathing and a sense of low self-worth, and we're deeply disappointed with all that we aren't doing that we should be doing because of some divine standard that we feel is being placed upon us. And I see what Jesus is trying to say to Peter here and what God is wanting us to know today. Jesus is asking Peter, do you love me above all else? Everything and anything in your life, am I more important than that to you? Do you love me without conditions? Do you love me with a fervent, white-hot, unfailing, ever-faithful, supernova explosion-like love? And Peter answers, you know all things, Lord. You know that I don't love you like that. I want to, but I can't hide it from you. I know that you see it. I only love you as a friend. That's the very best that I have to offer. That's the very best that I can do. And what Jesus is trying to get across in his response is something we don't see like we should. Jesus responds to Peter, feed my lambs, take care of my sheep, and feed my sheep are intended to say, I know you don't love me like that. And that's okay. I'll take whatever you're able to give. Whatever you are able to give, however you are able to love me, is enough. You are enough, and I still trust you with the work of God anyway. And if you study history, you find out that Peter is actually the one of the disciples, the apostles, that ends up becoming the head of the entire church. Anybody ever heard of a tiny little church in the Vatican called St. Peter's? Today is Easter Sunday, and churches all over the world are more full than they will be until Christmas. And unfortunately, what many people will hear this morning from albeit well-meaning teachers of Scripture is that Jesus died and rose that we might be free and whole and better at this thing that we call human existence than we were before he did all of those things. And yet this story teaches us something different. And if we miss it, we'll walk out of here today with an extremely distorted view of the nature and the purview of God. The profound truth that this is trying to teach us is that Peter doesn't love God as he should. And in that moment of honesty and transparency, Jesus tells him that he's good enough to continue doing the work of God anyway. Jesus wasn't trying to hurt Peter when he asked him that. He wasn't trying to shame Peter. He was trying to affirm his honesty. Peter was hurt because he realized he was less than he should be, especially after he's witnessed this man that rose from the dead. And if I'm honest with myself today, that's where I am most of the time in my life too. If I had agape for God all of the time instead of phileo, my life would look a lot different. But God doesn't demand false piety of us. We don't have to be something that we're not, as if we could hide who we really are from an omniscient presence anyway. God already knows who and what we really are, and that is enough. Brennan Manning once said this. For those who don't know Brennan, Brennan struggled with alcoholism his entire life, and it actually ended up causing his death. He died of something called wet brain. And if you read his writings, they're just beautiful, honest writings about his struggle with these things and his own struggle to believe that God could love him. He often had the easiest time explaining to thousands of people that would come to hear him speak. They would understand the love that God has for them, and Manning would go back to his hotel and down a fifth of bourbon, not understanding, not believing that God could love him that way. And he wrote this in the later years of his life. My message unchanged for more than 50 years is this. God loves you unconditionally as you are and not as you should be, because nobody is as they should be. This vulgar grace is indiscriminate compassion. It works without asking anything of us. It's not cheap, but it's free. And as such will always be a banana peel for the orthodox foot and a fairy tale for the grown-up sensibility. If asked whether I am finally letting God love me just as I am, I would answer, no, I don't, but I'm trying. My challenge for you today, whether you're here every Sunday or you're just visiting, is to call that kind of love to remembrance each time you have a thought flash through your mind that you aren't for God all that you feel that you should be for God. None of us are. That's what it is to be human. When the reality is that in the eyes and the heart of God, we are enough. Every morning when we wake up, every evening when we fall asleep, God knows. God knows that God is pleased with your fumbles and your failures and your frustrated half-starts and all that you feel that a life of faith demands of you. This Easter may be what people need to hear more than anything else. Because I don't know if you've noticed this or not, but when you come to church, you're often told of everything you need to add to your life to be a better person. This Easter, maybe what we need to know more than anything else is that you're enough. Let yourself off the hook. Give yourself a pass. Stop beating yourself up with a hammer that isn't there. Whether you think of God every moment of every day, or the idea of faith and spirituality only crosses your idea once a month, God is pleased with whatever you have to give. And if you can acknowledge that and lean into that and really believe that, you'll stop having a life of faith that's based on guilt and compulsion and pressure. And it will not become something that you do. It will start to become part of who you are. And that's what all of this is about. Jesus modeling for us what it means to be fully human so that we might be fully human as well. Let's stand and pray. God, Easter is it's an interesting animal. It's funny how we take a day and think it's just somehow got a little bit more spiritual spark to it than an average Monday morning. I pray that as we process all that we've learned today, that you would give us the courage to throw away our superstitions. That you would give us the courage to possibly believe that you're a little more good than we can possibly imagine. I pray that you would give us the wisdom to stop taking the things that we read and the things that we feel and the things that we think about you and turning them into self-improvement lists. I pray that you would help us to lighten up and to be kind to ourselves and easier with ourselves and to stop thinking this is about something that we earn. Being away from your love is trying to escape the air. And I pray that you would help us to breathe that in this season. Amen. You may be seated.